benefits of testosterone therapy are basically to relieve the symptoms that I mentioned before. If you're having issues such as irritability, nervousness, anxiousness, depression, we want those to get better, if not completely go away. We want to improve the libido. We want to improve sexual function. We also want to improve strength and endurance, improve recovery times. We get a lot of patients that report that they actually sleep better. These are all really important. I have a lot more patients on testosterone therapy that just feel a better quality of life. And that really can't be measured by any particular study or test. But if you feel better, you perform better at work, you perform better at home, generally you're a better husband, parent, and things of that nature. As far as side effects of testosterone therapy, there are a few. Most of those are dose related. So if we give you testosterone, pretty much all testosterone therapy is going to act like male birth control. And this is because when we provide an outside source of testosterone, your natural body's production is about 6 milligrams per day. And any outside source is going to supersede that. And that gives a feedback to the brain of there being too much testosterone at once. And this shuts down what's called the hypothalamus pituitary gonadal axis, the HPG axis. And in doing so, not only do we shut down your natural testosterone production, we also decrease your sperm production. So testosterone therapy acts like male birth control. So that's one side effect. And we can address that, and we'll talk about that here momentarily. Another side effect of testosterone replacement therapy can be acne. If you had acne as a teenager, you may get acne again. Generally with testosterone therapy, it's in the chest, shoulders, and back. And a lot of times it is related to the dose and or the delivery of testosterone. Typically, injectable testosterone is what causes the acne more frequently than other forms of testosterone delivery, such as transdermal or pellet therapy. We see an increase in the production of estradiol, but that's in proportion to the testosterone. So if you started off with a testosterone level of 300, your estradiol level should be around 15. If we improve your testosterone level to, let's say, 800, your estradiol will be about 40. It's about a 20-to-1 ratio. That's where it should be maintained. To say that somebody's estrogen level is too high just by looking at a number is a mistake, and it also confers to me that whoever's saying that really doesn't understand the physiology of hormones. If your testosterone level is 1,000 and your estradiol level is 50, that's perfect. If your estradiol level is 50 and your testosterone level is 500, you're probably producing too much in the way of estradiol. So this is kind of how we customize our programs and treat each individual as just that, an individual. Dihydrotestosterone is another derivative of testosterone replacement therapy. Dihydrotestosterone has been related to male pattern baldness, but male pattern baldness has many factors. So just to put it on testosterone, I think, is a mistake as well. There are plenty of balding men walking around with low testosterone levels, so it can't be just testosterone. You have to have the genetic predisposition for it, and about 50% of men have that genetic predisposition. The other 50% that don't have it, they can pretty much wash their hair with testosterone and it's not going to fall out at any greater rate. Men with high blood pressure, high cholesterol, diabetes, they also have a greater risk of male pattern baldness. So it's multifactorial, but dihydrotestosterone may play a role. It's important we don't want to block the production of dihydrotestosterone because it plays a very specific role in libido and erection strength. And drugs that block the production of dihydrotestosterone can have a long-term and sometimes permanent impact on lowering those. And in my opinion, it's not worth it. I wouldn't want to sacrifice my libido and my sexual prowess for a little extra hairs on my head. That's my own personal decision. Going back to the estradiol, the reason that a lot of doctors will say we're going to block the production of estradiol is to prevent gynecomastia, male breast tissue formation. I understand that and that reasoning, but it's not logical to me because it happens, in my experience, in less than 1% of my patient population. So I'm not going to use a drug that has a plethora of side effects to block something that's 99% likely not going to happen. What are the side effects of lowering the estradiol too much? Well, We have plenty of studies that show that estradiol is what really maintains bone strength and bone density in men. So by blocking it, we can increase our risk for osteopenia and osteoporosis. Estradiol protects the coronary arteries. So again, lowering the levels outside of the normal ratio can increase our risk for heart disease. And indeed, there's science and medical studies that suggest that it can increase your risk for heart disease up to threefold. We don't want to do that. Lowering the estradiol out of that ratio can increase belly fat, which also increases risk for heart disease and development of type 2 diabetes. This is visceral fat. There's a recent study from 2020 that looked at the conversion of testosterone to estradiol in the brain and said, this is the driving factor for a man's libido. So a drug that's going to block that is going to potentially kill a man's libido. And nobody who's going into testosterone replacement therapy wants any of those side effects. We want stronger bones. We want better muscle. We want less body fat. We want improved libido. So we have to be careful in thinking that we're just going to block estradiol to a very low level with the intent of preventing something that's 99% likely not going to happen. Male birth control, we kind of talked about with male birth control, as we're decreasing testicular production of testosterone and sperm, we may see some atrophy or shrinkage of the testicles. This can be prevented or mitigated somewhat with the use of a medication called HCG. Using HCG in conjunction with testosterone helps to maintain fertility. This is important for a lot of men that are wanting to potentially father children at some point in the future after starting testosterone replacement therapy. Secondary erythrocytosis. Secondary erythrocytosis is when the body produces more red blood cells than normal. This happens moving at altitude. If you were to live in Denver, Colorado, or a little higher in Vail, your body is going to produce more red blood cells secondary to the lower oxygen concentration in the air. We send our Olympic athletes to Colorado primarily to get that effect. This is a natural form of blood doping. This does not increase risk of blood clots and problems associated with blood clots. Testosterone does this all by itself without having the need to go at altitude. Testosterone creates secondary erythrocytosis. The studies on testosterone therapy do not show an increased risk of blood clot. However, there are many doctors who say that when the blood gets thick from testosterone, that it will increase the risk of a blood clot. The problem with this is it is not supported by the medical literature and it makes no sense. There are three things that are needed to increase the risk of a blood clot, and this is called Virchow's triad. Number one is stasis. That means that you're stuck in a bed or sitting for a long period of time. And that's why we see people that come from long flights that didn't get up and move around, sometimes they develop blood clots. Number two, you must have a hypercoagulable state. A cancer is a hypercoagulable state. And number three is trauma. Any trauma to an area can cause a hypercoagulable state or cause a blood clot. Without those, you're at a very, very low likelihood of having a blood clot, unless, of course, you have a genetic predisposition. If you have factor V von Leyden, issues like that, that can increase your risk of a blood clot. And there are specific testing that can be done to determine if you're at a generalized risk. Most of my patients would know if they had that because I'm seeing people generally around the age of 40 to 60 years old. And if they had a predisposition to a clot, they would have experienced it by then, one would think. Not always the case though. So increasing the amount of red blood cells does not automatically relate to an increase in the risk of blood clots. This is dogma, folklore, and tradition in medicine. The same goes with the idea of prostate cancer. For years and years, decades, endocrinologists, urologists, people in medical training were taught that testosterone caused prostate cancer, and taking testosterone therefore increased the risk of prostate cancer. Well, the story is only 50% true. Testosterone does relate to prostate cancer, but generally only small amounts. As a matter of fact, one of the more prevailing studies in the last few years has shown that men with low levels of testosterone are more prone to the most aggressive forms of prostate cancer. So this has really been studied and looked at, and we found that adding testosterone, doing testosterone replacement therapy, does not increase the risk of prostate cancer. Period. End of discussion. We've now taken what was dogma, folklore, and tradition, applied the science to it, studied it, and found that that is not true. Interestingly, some recent studies have also shown that men who are at risk for development of type 2 diabetes, they have insulin resistance, they're pre-diabetic, starting testosterone therapy reduces the risk of them progressing to type 2 diabetes. As a matter of fact, a couple of the studies said it prevents them from going into type 2 diabetes. And this is because testosterone stimulates lean muscle mass and decreases body fat all by itself. Now add that to diet and exercise and you get a much, much better result. If you suffer from any of these symptoms or you're concerned that your testosterone level may be low, please give us a call. We'd be happy to help you. We look forward to seeing you.